Blackstone Audio presents The Age of Voltaire, The Story of Civilization, Volume 9, by Will and Ariel Durant. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Apology. Blame for the length of this volume must rest with authors fascinated to exuberant prolixity by the central theme, that pervasive and continuing conflict between religion and science plus philosophy, which became a living drama in the 18th century, and which has resulted in the secret secularism of our times. How did it come about that a major part of the educated classes in Europe and America has lost faith in the theology that for 15 centuries gave supernatural sanctions and supports to the precarious and uncongenial moral code upon which Western civilization has been based? What will be the effects in morals, literature, and politics of this silent but fundamental transformation? The scale of treatment in each volume has grown with the increasing number of past events and personalities still alive in their influence and interest today. This and the multiplicity of topics, all aspects of civilization in Western Europe from 1715 to 1756, may offer some excuse for the proliferation of the tale. So the Age of Voltaire has burst its seams and spills over into a contemplated Part 10, Rousseau and Revolution, which will carry the story to 1789. This will look at the transformation of the world map by the Seven Years' War, the later years of Louis XV, 1756 to 74, the epoch of Johnson and Reynolds in England, the development of the Industrial Revolution, the flowering of German literature from Lessing to Goethe, of German philosophy from Herder to Kant, of German music from Gluck to Mozart, the collapse of feudalism in the France of Louis XVI, and the history of those peripheral nations, Sweden, Denmark, Poland, Russia, Turkey, Italy, Portugal, Spain, which have been deferred from this volume partly to save space, and is not directly involved, except through the papacy, in the great debate between reason and faith. This final volume will consider the later phases of that debate in the revolt of Rousseau against rationalism, and the heroic effort of Immanuel Kant to save the Christian theology through the Christian ethic. The perspective of the Age of Voltaire will be completed in that Part 10 of the Story of Civilization. The epilogue to the present volume reviews the case for religion. The epilogue to Rousseau and Revolution, surveying all 10 volumes, will face the culminating question: what are the lessons of history? We have tried to reflect reality by combining history and biography. The experiment will legitimately invite criticism, but it carries out the aim of integral history. Events and personalities go hand in hand through time, regardless of which were causes and which were effects. History speaks in events, but through individuals. This volume is not a biography of Voltaire. It uses his wandering and agitated life as connective tissue between nations and generations, and it accepts him as the most significant and illustrative figure of the period between the death of Louis XIV and the fall of the Bastille. Which, of all the men and women of that turbulent era, is more vividly remembered, more often read, more alive in influence today than Voltaire? "Voltaire," said Georg Brandes, "summarizes a century." "Le vrai roi du XVIIIe siècle," said Victor Cousin, "c'est Voltaire." Let us follow that living flame through his century. Prologue. Chapter 1. France, the Regency, 1715 to 23. 1. The Young Voltaire, 1694 to 1715. He was not yet Voltaire. Till his release from the Bastille in 1718, he was François-Marie Arouet. He was born in Paris on November 21, 1694, and became its distilled essence till 1778. His presumptive father, François Arouet, was an affluent attorney, acquainted with the poet Boileau and the courtesan Ninon de l'Enclos, whose wills he wrote, and with the dramatist Pierre Corneille, whom he described as the most boring mortal he had ever met. The mother, Marie-Marguerite d'Aumar, was of slightly noble lineage, daughter of an official of the Parlement, and sister of the Comptroller General of the Royal Guard. Through them, she had access to the court of Louis XIV. Her vivacity and sprightly wit made her home a minor salon. Voltaire thought she possessed all the intellect in his parentage, as his father had all the financial skill. The son absorbed both of these gifts into his heritage. She died at the age of 40 when he was 7. Of her 5 children, the eldest was Armand, who adhered zealously to the Jansenist theology and the patrimonial property. François-Marie, the youngest child, was so sickly in his first year that no one believed he could survive. He continued till his 84th year to expect and announce his early death. Among the friends of the family were several abbés. This title, meaning father, was given to any secular ecclesiastic, whether or not he was an ordained priest. Many abbés, while continuing to wear ecclesiastical dress, became men of the world and shone in society. Several were prominently at home in irreverent circles. Some lived up to their title literally but clandestinely. The abbé de Châteauneuf was the last lover of Ninon de l'Enclos and the first teacher of Voltaire. He was a man of wide culture and broad views. He passed on to his pupil the paganism of Ninon and the skepticism of Montaigne. According to an old but questioned story, he introduced to the boy a mock epic, La Moisade, which was circulating in secret manuscripts. Its theme was that religion, aside from belief in a supreme being, was a device used by rulers to keep the ruled in order and awe. Voltaire's education proceeded when his abbé tutor took him on a visit to Ninon. The famous hetaira was then, 1704, 84 years old. François found her dry as a mummy, but still full of the milk of woman's kindness. "It pleased her," he later recalled, "to put me in her will. She left me 2,000 francs to buy books with." She died soon afterward. To balance this diet, he was entered, age 10, as a resident student at the Jesuit College of Louis le Grand on the left bank of Paris. It was reputed the best school in France. Among its 2,000 pupils were such sons of the nobility as could bear an education. In his 7 years there, Voltaire made many of the aristocratic friends with whom he maintained an easy familiarity throughout his life. He received a good training in the classics, in literature, and especially in drama. He acted in plays presented there, and, aged 12, wrote a play himself. He did well in his studies, won many prizes, and delighted and alarmed his teachers. He expressed disbelief in hell and called heaven the great dormitory of the world. One of his teachers sadly predicted that this young wit would become the standard-bearer of French deism. That is, a religion that discarded nearly all theology except belief in God. They endured him with their customary patience, and he reciprocated by retaining, through all his heresies, a warm respect and gratitude for the Jesuits who had disciplined his intellect to clarity and order. He wrote when he was 52, "I was educated for 7 years by men who took unrewarded and indefatigable pains to form the minds and morals of youth. They inspired in me a taste for literature and sentiments which will be a consolation to me to the end of my life. Nothing will ever efface from my..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.